start off by saying that this bill is far from perfect. Only a very limited number of employees will have the personal resources necessary to make the provisions of this amendment, to be able to access these provisions. That said, it is a step forward, although a very small step forward, and for that reason I will be supporting this bill in expectation that this is only the first of some many other following steps forward, and greater provisions will come in the future. In Ontario, many families are put in difficult situations. They have seriously ill family members, but the current employment protections do not go far enough to allow them to care for seriously ill family members who are not in a terminal or life-threatening situation. This bill addresses that concern, and it creates a provision for a family caregiver to take up to 8 weeks unpaid leave without the fear of losing their job, a regulation that should have been in place years ago, and an amendment that will become even more important with our aging population and greater need for family members to pull together to care for loved ones. As I have said, this bill is weak. It's another half measure by this government. And probably the most glaring weakness is that there isn't any income support for those taking the leave, meaning that only those with the financial resources will be able to take time away from their jobs to care for their loved ones. This is a weakness, and many people will simply be unable to afford the 8 weeks without any income. I don't think I'd be stretching too much to suggest that many families in Ontario today would find 2 weeks unpaid leave completely unaffordable. But at the very least, this amendment sets the groundwork for future advances, and I'm hopeful that sometime in the next few years, there will be political will to provide income supports for these workers to help ensure that more families can take advantage of this employment protection. One thing I have not heard, but I'd like to hear, would be a cost-benefit analysis providing income supports in a case like this. I would suspect that the cost of the system would be much less expensive to help cover the income of a family member or spouse for 8 weeks, even if it is a percentage of their regular income, than it would be for the government to cover the cost of health care and support workers for the ill family member. Because we know that many social programs, such as this one, actually come at a net benefit to the taxpayer. A notable example being from the reports that suggest that full-day kindergarten saves the government money through savings and other programs. So I'd certainly like to see an analysis of this, if this could be the case for this program. We know that investing is not only the right thing to do, but it actually maximizes our tax dollars. I would, of course, be remiss if I didn't acknowledge that the most likely funding source for an income supplement program like this would be through the federal government's employment insurance program. So I will admit that the fault for this shortcoming may not necessarily lie with the provincial government. That said, I hope the Minister of Labour could give her assurances that they will lobby the federal government to make the changes necessary to ensure that this program is accessible to all workers and not just the lucky few who can afford to take an 8-week unpaid absence from their job. Of course, in an ideal world, we wouldn't need a piece of legislation like this. In an ideal world, employers would happily provide their workers with some level of compassionate leave. And I'm sure that some do, but we all know that this is not an ideal world and that unfortunately we have to legislate based on the lowest common denominator. And with this in mind, I do think, again, that this is a step in the right direction. Another provision that I do have some concern with is this bill's impacts on very small business and essential services. As it stands, this bill does not stand a minimum number of employees, and it does not seem to exempt certain essential sectors, and I do worry that the potential exists for some problems in this regard. In many communities, small businesses are a very literal term. The small stores or other operations may have one or two employees. If one of those employees suddenly takes 8 weeks leave, it does have the potential to pose an undue hardship on the other employees or the business owner. But I know in these circumstances, most of these small businesses are tight-knit communities and almost like families where the employer would more than likely encourage their employee to take the time to care for their family and return to work when they're able. Likewise, I worry about the provision, how this would affect essential services in small communities such as police officers, where again, there isn't always the staff complement necessary to fill in for a prolonged absence. That said, I'm sure
As there seems to be about six sidebars going on, I'm having difficulty listening to the speaker. If you want to have sidebars, I suggest you go outside. Thank you.
That there, these are larger organizations, and they will find ways to adapt and find short-term solutions to fill the staff complement. While I do worry about the impact on smaller staff operations, I'm hopeful that the provisions of this amendment will come under review, and if there is need to accommodate small business, the government will be agreeable to that in the future. As happens with all new legislation, there will be hiccups along the way. But I believe that this is a good step, and although a minor first step, it does have the potential to have a positive impact on family across the province, and even greater impact when income supports are in place and that all the problems are ironed out. I am hopeful that the committee charged with reviewing this bill will seek submissions from some of the organizations that could be adversely affected by the legislation and propose amendments that they deem necessary to make this a workable plan for Ontario business. The other thing I'd like to talk about is protection for employers. I think in particular of tourist operators in my region. Many of these businesses are what you could call mom and pop operations, where the owners do the majority of the work, including the cooking, cleaning, renovations, and meeting the needs of their guests. Their only employees may be guides or casual positions that are brought on purely by demand, meaning the employee is booked for a particular week because there is a guest who wants a guided trip. Guides are extremely skilled and knowledgeable individuals whose work simply cannot be filled by someone coming off of the street. So if the guide were to cancel at the last minute and the owner were unable to fulfill the request due to other commitments, such as guiding a group of their own, it leaves the guest unhappy. They talk to their friends and business drops. Anyone who knows the tourism industry in the Northwest knows that business is built on repeat business. A satisfied customer may visit the same lodge for 10, 20, or 30 years. Over the course of that time, in an extremely tough industry to make a living, that's how we lose a lot of business, if we are unable to satisfy a guest for any particular time. So I would certainly encourage the committee to ask the tourism industry for their thoughts on this bill. That said, I think it's important to offer this type of leave. It's important to protect the jobs of people who are facing serious family illness. The problem is that this bill does not go far enough, it has no income protection, and I wonder about it having adequate inspection. We all know that the current Employment Standards Act is almost a joke. If you have a union, you're okay. If you don't have a union, you've got literally no protection. And I've seen that working in the constituency office in my former job when I worked with the former MPP. There I helped a man who worked in one of the small communities of my riding. He was working for a year at this company. He was on the management track. He did all sorts of dirty and difficult jobs. He went above and beyond, and he received excellent performance reviews. And yet, he was let go so that the company could hire the owner's cousin, who had less experience. In that situation, the Employment Standards Act did nothing to help this individual. And so, while I will support practically any measure that will strengthen our Employment Standards Act, this bill doesn't go far enough.